Anger and Aggression Management, created by the Centre of Excellence, narrated by Jane Branch.
Centre of Excellence, Anger and Aggression Management, Module 1, The Roots of Anger and Aggression. Why do we get angry? Emotions like anger are very complicated. While we may not like it, anger is a fact of life. Everyone gets angry every now and then. However, if you feel like anger and aggression have become a part of your daily life, then it may be time to take a closer look at exactly what is going on. Anger is a natural human emotion. Although it is sometimes unwanted, it is all a part of the human experience. Anger experts describe anger as a primary natural emotion and an emotion that has evolved over time. In some ways, anger helps protect us from what we consider a wrongdoing. Mild anger can be brought on by things like being tired, feeling stressed, feeling irritated, lack of sleep. You may also experience mild anger if your basic human needs are not being met. We may also become angry when reacting to things like criticisms or frustrations or a threat, and this is not necessarily an inappropriate or a bad reaction. We can also feel angry or irritated by things like the news, other people's beliefs or opinions, and or even someone's actions. Anger can affect our ability to communicate effectively, making us more likely to do or say unreasonable or irrational things. What is anger? Anger is a response to feelings of unhappiness or irritation, which in turn arise whenever we meet with unpleasant circumstances. Whenever we are prevented from fulfilling our wishes, or we feel as if we're forced into something that we don't like or are trying to avoid, our mind immediately reacts by expressing feelings of unhappiness. This uncomfortable feeling can easily turn into anger, causing us to feel even more disturbed. Every day, we encounter hundreds of situations that can lead to anger. When we stub our toe, or become angry with our spouse, our nerves become frayed. Anger is a dangerous emotion both for others and for ourselves, yet it is a very common and very human emotion. Types of anger. Aggressive anger. Aggressive anger might be thought of as a type of primal instinct. Animals resort to aggressive behaviours when they fight or posture against each other. In fact, when we are angry, our values change, causing us to go from being nice to inflicting harm. People can engage in aggressive behaviour as a result of a threat or even attacking words. Defensive anger. Defensive anger occurs when your fight or flight response is triggered for some reason. This gives us a boost of adrenaline, which allows us to fight off our attacker. To fight, you need to be quick and you need to hit hard. To run away, you need speed and agility. Outraged anger. This type of anger occurs when we feel outraged by something in society. As a society, we live by certain rules. When someone breaks those rules, we feel angered and outraged. Moral outrage is a common tool of newspapers and other media outlets that amplify things with emotive language to trigger widespread anger. Frustrated anger. Everyone gets frustrated every now and then. Many things cause frustration, from failure to achieve simple goals to something simple like missing the bus or getting to work late. When things do not go our way, we quickly become frustrated and angry. This is why traffic jams are so annoying. When things happen that are out of our control, we tend to vent our anger verbally and on those around us. Road rage is a common example of this. Frustration is a big source of stress, and yet we still let it happen. We may direct our anger inward, criticize ourselves for lack of planning, or blame other people. It's important to understand anger so it does not control you. Anger can provoke us to do things we would not normally do or say, which is why it is such an irrational emotion. Anger myths and development of aggressive behavioural patterns. Myth number one. Aggression is genetic. Aggression is not a single solitary trait. Aggression is not something that has evolved as a whole, but rather more like a suite of behaviours that have a dynamic and complex range of expression. While some may argue that aggression is genetic and that humans are aggressive by nature, that isn't necessarily the case. Myth number two. Aggression is a physiological system or part of the body that has been favoured over evolutionary time. This is also not true. The truth is, there is no single thing or pattern that we can specifically measure and label as aggressive. While we do know that certain parts of the brain, like the prefrontal cortex, the amygdala, and the hypothalamus, interact with certain neurotransmitters like serotonin and hormones like testosterone to produce aggressive behaviour, we also see that there is no specific physiological or neurological system designed for aggression. Everything that is involved in the expression of aggression is tied to other systems, and its use in behaviour is highly contextual. Myth number three, the warrior gene. Monoamine oxidase A, the warrior gene, is a gene associated with hyperaggression in males. However, expression of this gene is related to childhood stressors and life experience, as opposed to a clear genetic link. A slightly larger percentage of men with the aggressive version of this gene, those who live through real childhood trauma and social stress and are highly violent, may have trouble controlling their behaviour as adults. However, many of those with the warrior version of this gene don't have these problems at all. These same kinds of complexities are also true for the hormones and neurotransmitters associated with aggression. In the end, there is no consistent system or pattern in the human body or in the mind that we can point out as the seat or the root cause of aggressive behaviour. Social learning theory of aggression. According to social learning theory, or SLT, social learning is learning through observation, imitation, and modelling. According to Albert Bandura, a psychologist who is the David Starr Jordan Professor Emeritus of Social Science in Psychology at Stanford University, there are four processes involved with social learning: attention, notice; retention, remember; reproduction, copy; and motivation. Attention occurs when someone copies something that is popular at the time, like having pink hair. Initially, someone has to pay attention to someone who has pink hair. They then have to remember it. Next comes copying it, which also involves motivation to do so. An individual is more likely to imitate someone who has status, power, or is the same gender. The more similar the role model, the more likely the behaviour will be imitated. Bandura also stated that observing the consequences of another person's behaviour influences us. Children observe and learn from role models. These might be role models at home, from school, or from the media. Social learning theory evolved from operant conditioning, which considers the effect of observing other people being rewarded and how this shapes our own behaviour. According to this theory, aggressive behaviour can be learned by imitating and observing the aggressive behaviour of others. Bandura used the term modelling to explain how humans can very quickly learn specific acts of aggression and then incorporate them into their behaviour.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.